Welcome to the Medical Device Made Easy podcast. Here is Munir Alazouzi from easymedicaldevice.com. And today we will talk about MDR. So the title of our episode of today is MDR is coming. But Eric had sent me an image where it says, brace yourself, MDR is coming. So it's maybe not the same message here. So we have that. So my guest today, as I said, Eric Volbrecht. So Eric, welcome to the Medical Device Made Easy podcast.
Hi, Munir. Glad to be with you again.
Yeah, so we are at 1 week, 1 week from the EU MDR. I think when the episode will be released, it will be really 1 week from the EU MDR. So the idea of today, I mean, the question that I have to ask first, because we talked about that since now, I think I started the podcast 2 years ago. We talk about MDR since a long time, and we said it will not be postponed, it will not be postponed, it will not be postponed. And surprise, coronavirus arrived and it was postponed for 1 year. Now people are saying to me, oh, maybe there is a rumor that it will be postponed. So will it be postponed?
Again?
Yeah, no. Again, I don't know.
No. Remember that last time they postponed it, they did it as quickly as they could possibly do it legislatively. And if they would have wanted to postpone it before the date of application, then they would have needed at least a month. If we would have known if anything was going on. I do hear some rumors about the IVDR possibly being postponed, but okay. The MDR, no, it's not going to happen anymore. So we're going to have to MacGyver our way through the MDR at this point. If you still think it's going to be postponed, then no.
Yeah, so no postponement anymore. So we have to do that. I mean, I've started a series where every day I try to give you a topic, and some people told me, oh, you are stressing us with your videos because it says day minus 30, day minus 40. So it's like, oh, we know that it's coming now. It's not like they will be postponed. But what you say, when you say IVDR will maybe be postponed, I mean, IVDR is for next year. We are still saying that there is really an urgency here. We don't have a lot of notified bodies, and there is more manufacturers under IVDR that will be needing a notified body. Before they were self-certified, and now the proportion of self-certification is like 20%, is really a low proportion. So why do you think that IVDR should be postponed first, maybe?
Well, I mean, I don't really have a personal opinion about whether it should be postponed or not. But if you look at, on the one hand, if you would compare it to the MDR, right? And you would say that, let's say, 85% of all devices on the market is currently self-certified and needs a CE certificate under the IVDR, right? So that's a lot, basically. That's more than a qualified majority. Now, there are less notified bodies that even applied for the IVDR. There are much less notified bodies that are even notified at the moment. Just four?
Yeah, four.
Can count them on a single hand. Those are some of the big ones, but still it's not nearly sufficient capacity. And also remember, and this is something that people often forget, with the MDR, we had the second corrigendum that said, "Hey, if you need a notified body under the MDR, then you can still issue a valid declaration of conformity before the date of application, and you can sit out your declaration of conformity and get your MDR certificate later." This has not happened for the IVDR yet. So that's kind of a problem because it means that still 85 to 90% of the devices in the market still needs to push themselves through this very narrow capacity hole of these four notified bodies. And I'm still saying four because the funnel of notified bodies is really, really slow. And if you speak to the notified bodies that have done IVDR and MDR, they will tell you that basically the bottleneck is in the period where a notified body has had their joint assessment, has handed in a CAPA plan,
yeah,
and the signing off on the CAPA plan, that is basically delaying everything. So We have, I think from top of my head, we had 11 or 12 notified bodies in the pipeline for IVD to begin with, for IVDR. And yeah, so basically seven are still stuck in the pipeline this way, and they might not be in time. And also, don't forget, once a notified body is notified, they are not immediately at full capacity, because notified bodies are not allowed to actually start to do full preparation before they are notified. So that means that they will need a couple of more months to basically get up to steam. So before a notified body is at full certification capacity, that usually takes 4 to 6 months,
yeah,
which means that any notified body capacity that is added, not added this year, will not make a difference even. And even if they are at full capacity, they need 8 months at least for a certification. So then you count back even further. So any notified body that is not added by the end of the third quarter of this year, right, which is basically before September,
yeah,
will not make any difference.
And what is important here is also that so we have a number of four notified bodies, if I can say, as we said, for that. We have a lot of manufacturers that are on the pipe also for that. And we suppose that there is also a lot of manufacturers that have no clue or that have no understanding of this change of situation. Because as you said, they were self-certified. It means that they never had to discuss with a notified body before. And now they need a notified body, but they have no clue how it is working. So I suppose there is this kind of thing that can be also creating a problem for them.
Yeah, obviously. Yeah. And also there are quite a lot of companies that are taking the strategy, okay, we are just going to play stupid and then hope that some kind of solution comes along. Huh? We've seen that with MDR as well. And now it looks like the MDR, there are some rumors that there is a movement to maybe postpone it, but then still you don't know what postponement will look like. And so, because let's say they move the date of application with 1 year, like they did with the MDR. So what do you get? You get a grace period of 1 year. Is that going to help you? So basically, no. I would say with the MDR, we had a grace period of 3 years, which is even too short, because what did everybody do with the grace period? Everybody piled their certificates up and back, which means that still we will not have enough notified body capacity towards the end. And in a year, it won't be possible. It's just going to be a total cluster beep, basically.
Yeah. So I think the message is, if you are IVD, an IVD manufacturer, you have really to understand, to make a plan, to make a strategy, a scenario, as Eric says usually on my podcast. So make scenarios for that and to be ready for the next year. You should be ready for next year. Maybe there will be a postponement, but don't think about that. Just try to be ready mainly for next year.
Basically, people shouldn't forget that the IVDR is not at the point that they have this sort of grandfather-like construction for self-certified IVDs as they had for the MDR. And that is really important, because in the MDR, they managed to fudge that in with a corrigendum. After that, the European Parliament said, we are not going to allow ourselves to be abused again for this kind of bypassing of legislative procedure. So you can be sure that for the IVDR, they will want to do this according to the proper legislative procedure. That's going to take time.
Yeah. So I think the message is now passed for the IVDR. I have a series of questions for MDR that people ask me related to the date of application, to the fact there are still MDDs, to the fact how it will be working on during this transition period. And I wanted to get your opinion on that. So the first question is that there is this Article 1 of the EU MDR, which is excluding some products to be regulated by the MDR, but they were regulated before by the MDD. So now it's excluded. So you are now here in the middle of two things. Yep. For those first, maybe can we remind what are those products that are excluded, if you have a list of or some examples? And if they are excluded, which regulation they have to follow now?
Yeah, so that's a good question. One of the problems I see most in the market are the devices that have a viable component. So the Article 16H products, which are now excluded from MDR scope. And so you would typically be looking at, for example, a medical device containing probiotics with viable bacteria. I've been dealing with that kind of case myself, I found that it is complicated, let's put it like that, because as usually with law that is not super well drafted, you can go all kinds of directions, and it is a bit of which Russian doll is bigger, to put it into a metaphor. Because why is that? Article 16H says these products are not in scope of the MDR.
Okay.
On the other hand, Article 100, these are also products that under the NDD could have a valid CE certificate.
Okay.
Right? So I have clients with products that have a valid CE certificate now. So then you think, oh, nice, I have a valid CE certificate. I read Article 120.
Yeah.
Article 120, Section 2 says, congratulations, you have a valid CE certificate. That means that you can sit it out until the end. And then you look in Article 120, Section 3 for the conditions. Oh, cool, I can sit it out until maximum of the end of the grace period. Fantastic, my notified body gave me a CE certificate until 26 May 2024.
I'm fine.
I am golden. And then you get member states that are saying, some member states are saying, no, that's not true, because since the product is excluded from scope in Article 16H, you can't go under the, you can't benefit from the transitional regime. Now, and then you get into this really weird sort of what goes first? Which clause trumps what? Does Article 16H trump Article 120, Section 2? Or the other way around? Now, I would think personally, but of course I'm defending my poor clients that see their e-certificates taken away, is I would think that if the MDR intended that certain valid certificates would not be covered by the Article 120 regime, that you would put in Article 120, Section 2, this does not apply to products that are out of scope for the MDR for under Article 16, right?
Yeah. So this is something that is there kind of a discussion actually with the EU Commission about that, or for them it's like no, stop discussion, and now anything that is excluded and we are not talking anymore about that. So from the 26th of May, all the products that are with probiotics or viable organism, they have to stop their marketing, or what they should do then?
Well, that's also one of the things that the MDR doesn't say. Right? There are no consequences for this kind of certificate, because what would be the consequence then? That by the date of application, your certificate is suddenly magically invalid? Nobody knows. I mean, there's not a provision for that in the MDR, which in my view means that this is a permutation that the legislator has not considered. Now, if there's a permutation that the legislator has not considered, then of course you get into the interesting question, so what will apply? If you look in the MDR FAQ made by the CAMD in December 2017, question 14, it says, yes, these products are out of scope of the MDR and they can't go under the MDR, period. No argumentation, no legal argument. Now, there are some member states like Ireland and France, they say, okay, so you can't, if you are a manufacturer and you're based on our territory, we will enforce if you keep placing these products on the market. So basically, they're forcing you into a voluntary withdrawal and otherwise they will enforce. Whereas I've also seen member states like Germany and Italy, for example, they're perfectly okay with that. So then what you can, yeah, what can you do as a company? I mean, it's tricky. You could, for example, say, okay, if I'm located in Ireland or France, I would just move my manufacturer to another member state, see what happens. Then I might not be able to sell in Ireland or France, but I'll work around it that way. But on the other hand, yeah, it's just weird. And also remember that CAMD has no formal competence to interpret the MDR, yeah, actually.
Exactly.
Because it's the NDCG, not the CAMD. CAMD can say what they want. They can play the banjo until the cows come home, but they have no formal competence. It's just member states talking and not the NDCG. So also there, I think that they thought they were looking for a practical solution and then made it more complicated.
So, but it means that if I can say, if those products are not MDR anymore, if there is no regulation outside of that, they are not illegal. They can still be placed on the market without any regulation.
Oh, no. That's probably also not how it works, because of course we've got other legislation. That's because the only thing we have now is the MDR, basically sort of pushing these products out of the nest, right? Saying, yeah, you are not a device anymore. Fly, fly, little birdie, non-device. So then the question is, so what are they? And the problem is that if they are not under the MDR, they are likely, they could be food, depending on the claim, because if you ingest them. But if they're probiotics, people will probably make medical claims, which takes them out of the scope of food, or still might be, you might still have a, I don't know, improved function claim or how do you call it for food. But again, there you have to scientifically substantiate it. You might have food that says sustains healthy bowel flora or something like that. That is something that you need to substantiate under the food claims regulation. And also it might be a medicine. And we all know what happens if competent authority thinks it's convenient that something is a medicine. They will immediately invoke the hierarchy provision and say, when in doubt, it's medicine. Oh, we have a lot of doubts because we are not going to even discuss the actual mechanism of your product. So we are just going to stick our fingers in our ears and shout la, 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 and say it's a medicinal product and you and see you in court.
And it's something that is interesting because I remember when I was working in pharma medical device industry, I read the 2001-83 EC, and there is this sentence saying, if you have a doubt, it is a drug. So then it's saying that inside. So,
there's a bit more nuance than that, because basically the European Court of Justice has clarified that as to say, if a product can be regulated under the Medicinal Products Directive and other product regulations, so if it's in the scope of both, then, and there is doubt about which one should take precedence, in that case, the medicinal products
win.
takes precedence. But of course, then I've always seen member states basically jump over that with a big leap and say, we have doubts, it's a medicine.
Okay.
Good luck.
So, yeah, so as you said, this is something that maybe we'll have more information about. But we have, for people that are interested, you go to Article 1.6 and you will see exactly which are the products that are excluded. And this is mainly what we talk about today, is mainly the same situation for all those products. The second question is about economic operators. I am an MDD product. I have an MDD product. I sell that in Europe. Should my economic operators follow MDR for that, or should they follow MDD for my product because I am MDD? So is there a rule here, or now it says importer should do that, so they have to do that?
Yeah, this is another one like these Russian doll problems as the one we've just discussed, right? Because on the one hand, you've got the situation MDR, date of application, MDR is applicable to all devices on the market, except if there is an exemption, for example, for MDD products that can go under Article 120, Section 3, provided that they implement certain quality system requirements from the MDR. Now, there are two ways to interpret that provision. I've done a podcast with Gert Bos on QSERF, where we explain that in a lot of detail, because you can say two things, right? You can say Article 120, Section 3 is a self-contained regime that applies to MDD products. And that means that MDD products after the date of application only have to do what is listed in Article 120, Section 3. So that is registration of economic operators, registration of products, and that's it. Vigilance and that. But with regard to economic operators, it doesn't say have to do full importer and distributor PRC and that kind of stuff. It's one way to look at it. The other way to look at it is the way I have seen several competent authorities look at it, and they say, we have a date of application. We already had a transitional period before the date of application. For some old MDD products, we have a runoff period in the grace period, but there is a date of application and there was a transitional period leading up to the date of application in which, as a manufacturer, you should have made sure that you were prepared. Now, then the argument is, well, but there are also, the MDR has a mechanism for delaying certain things that are not immediately applicable on the date of application. And these things can all be found in Article 123, Section 3, that has a whole list of things that are delayed with alternative dates. So these competent authorities takes a position that everything that is not explicitly delayed is applicable as of date of application. So that means Article 11, Article 12 on the authorized representative, because that's really interesting. You never hear people that have the theory that they shouldn't apply Article 13 or 14. You never hear them say, oh yeah, but Article 12 is not applicable, Article 11 is not applicable. They are always cherry picking, which I find very interesting. Because this is, I mean, either all the provisions from the economic operator chapter are applicable, so also 15, 16, 18 implant card. And you never hear people about that unless they have implants. But so competent authorities say, no, it is applicable. What I've also seen is notified bodies also say, actually, it's applicable. Actually, this week on the reps conference, PSI went on the record saying, yeah, of course, PRC is applicable for MDD devices. So if you have an MDD device and you don't have a PRC by the time of your first surveillance audit into the grace period, you will get a major nonconformity. So, I mean, it's nice. You can sort of decide that you're not going to play by those rules, but then you will run into competent authorities and you will run into notified bodies. And I know it's a difficult discussion because I know that in MedTech Europe's economic operator group, this has been a bone of contention for years, with factions arguing this and factions arguing that. But in the end, there were just a lot of big ones, big MedTech Europe members that said, we are not going to work with dual quality systems for economic operators for MDD and MDR. We are just going to lump everything together, which sort of ended the debate, and they also didn't want to have to fight themselves out of their problem when it turns out that the authorities and the notified bodies are going to push back to them.
So in terms of PRRC, just to come back to this point, because it was also one of the questions that I wanted to get for. For PRRC, so what you are saying that even if you are MDD, you need to have a PRRC, but it's not something that is mentioned, if I can say, on the MDD directive. So what is the point to say, yes, we need a PRRC when you are MDD?
The exact same point as you would say that Article 11 about authorized representatives, Article 12 about authorized representative change, Article 13 about importers, Article 14 about distributors, and Article 15 about PRC. It's just applicable.
So for manufacturers we talk, huh?
Yes.
Okay. So manufacturers, if you are MDD, find a PLC immediately. So this is also something that is really important. One thing about economic operator that I want also to clarify.
Yeah, or call me if you want to have a fight about it. That's fine too. I mean, I love intellectual puzzles, so I will gladly fight a good fight. But I'm not sure it's the best way to spend your time and money.
I mean, apparently, one of the requirements of the EUMDR is also that even if you are MDD, you have to follow vigilance reporting, post-marketing surveillance, etc., which is something that is the function of the PRRC. So it's mainly also something that is
missing. Yeah, so I mean, what's the additional burden to just task somebody with that? It's an additional thing, but it's not total rocket science or something.
And you can hire a consultant for that. So don't hesitate to find a consultant who can do that if you are a small business.
No, if you are small, yes. Yeah. If you're big, then you have to have your
own. No choice. One thing about economic operator that we discussed is that there is some misconception or misunderstanding about two terms, which are placing on the market and making available. So what is the difference and why is it so important to understand that?
Yeah, it's the difference is that placing on, basically the core concept in CE marking legislation is making available. Making available is every little step in the supply chain. And placing on the market is the first making available in the union with a capital U. So basically in the medical device regulated space of the EU. The union is bigger because it also contains Turkey, Switzerland. Switzerland not anymore after 26 May. Turkey, possibly. We still don't know. It's completely silent about Turkey. Very scary. But then Norway, Liechtenstein, Iceland, happy places like that. These are part of the union. Now, so why is placing on the market so important? Because, again, Article 120, I think it's the most read article these days, says that if you have placed products on the market before the date of application, they can still freely circulate on the market even until 27 May 2025. So you've got 5 years to sell them off. But then they need to be placed on the market. And placed on the market is a term that is clarified. It's a defined term in the MDR, but it's interpreted in a lot of detail in the blue guide, which everybody that has not read the blue guide, go outside, open your car door, slam your fingers in it because you deserve it if you haven't read the blue guide by now, because you shouldn't be asking yourself these questions. Blue guide is really fantastic. And so there are a lot of misconceptions now, because now actually companies start to think like, oh shit, I have this batch of products that is never going to comply with the MDR anymore, but is compliant with the MDD. I am going to place them on the market before the date of application. And there I see a lot of consultants and also other lawyers giving really, really bad advice, probably because they haven't read the blue guide. But because they are saying things like, well, in order for products to be placed on the market, the importer has to own them. It's not true. Because the blue guide says, well, a transfer of ownership is an assumption of a transfer that leads to making available, but it's not a necessary condition. Or they are saying, well, the products have to be physically in the warehouse of the importer. It's also not true because actually we've seen with the latest guidance from the Brexit about industrial products, the March 2020 version, where they discuss on pages 8 and 9 quite a number of interesting permutations about placing on the market. One of which where it says, no problem if the products are still underway, as long as there is a transaction that with a distributor, that could also be an importer based in the EU, so you are sure that the product is going to be placed on the market in the union. In that case, even if the product counts as placed on the market. I had a Japanese client, for example, last week. They had a few containers of capital equipment stuck where? Yes.
In In a, what in a, in the in the at the border or?
No, no, on the Ever Given, this ship.
Ah, yeah, Evergreen, this big container, yeah, true.
Still being sequestered by the Egyptian authorities somewhere in this lake in the Suez Canal. And they were like, oh no, these products will never arrive in Europe in time to be placed on the market. And I said, well, that you can solve this by making sure that you have a distributor order linked to the serials of these capital equipment, and then they count as placed on the market as long as that order is in place before the date of application.
So what is interesting, it says also that it should not be, it's not mandatory that it's paid, it can be also for free, so you can also provide something for free
and it's not donated. You can donate the goods, even better write it down, but
exactly, and it should be just that there is a transfer and there is a kind of a new owner, if I can say, of this, but not physically, but also mainly on the documentation.
And you need to show a clear intent that the product is going to circulate in the union, because the fact that it's destined to be to clear customs in the union, or destined to physically go to the union, doesn't mean that it will actually be placed on the market there. So you really need to be able to show that you have a union customer for this. Because if it goes to a warehouse in the union, whether customs bonded or not, and for these products, it's still not clear that they will always be distributed in the union. And as long as that's not clear, they can't count as placed on the market.
So if I am a manufacturer, I manufacture 1 million units of a product, it is on my stock. It is not somewhere else. I release that paper, I release that, it is on my stock. This is not placed on the market.
Correct. Yeah, if it's still sitting in manufacturer stock, and that's also what it says in guidance, that if it's still sitting in manufacturer stock, then it's not placed on the market. You really need it to be transacted. It has to clear production. So that's clear manufacturing stage, which is also sometimes difficult if it's still in manufacturing stock. And there has to be intent to distribute on the union market. And for that, you need to prove that you need to prove with a transaction, preferably with a European, with a union party.
No, I think it's clear here. We had also one case about e-commerce. The fact that you are selling your products on the e-commerce on the internet, there is also some good advice that they are on the blue guide about that.
Well, not so much on the blue guide, because, well, yes and no, basically, because the blue guide already had a section speaking about fulfillment services providers that could be distributors under certain circumstances, which had everything to do with e-commerce. But we also, and that's something that people often forget, we have the market surveillance regulation becoming applicable actually on 16 July. And that regulation has a clause that says if there is no importer, for example, because the manufacturer is based outside of the union and sells products directly to the end customer, then in those cases, the fulfillment services provider in the union may be seen as a regulated economic operator and needs to do the verification that the economic operator has to do. So Amazon, congratulations. This is probably one for you.
So I think it's interesting because, I think there is a lot of things that like that maybe people don't know and that will come, and maybe at one point they will have this responsibility without knowing that, and which is maybe something that can be a big problem. Okay, so another question about OEM OBL, so own brand labeling, original equipment manufacturer. This is something that was authorized, if I can say, or accepted within the MDD, where your original equipment manufacturer has a CE certificate, and you as an OBL have also a CE certificate, but all the parts related to the manufacturing, you reference, if I can say, the CE certificate from the OBM, which is not authorized anymore with the EU MDR. So, what is the alternative that those manufacturers have to have then?
Well, there are several alternatives. Basically, the MDR proceeds from the point that you cannot be a little bit pregnant. So you cannot be a little bit manufacturer like they were under the OBL construction, right? Because then then the, let's say, the customer manufacturers would have an abbreviated technical documentation, which would all refer back to the technical documentation of the core product, that then their notified body could go look there. Not allowed anymore. The MDR says, if you want to wear your big boy pants and be a manufacturer, you are a manufacturer all the way, which means Article 10.8 says that you need to have full technical documentation for your device. Now, they call that also virtual manufacturing, because it's still allowed to have your device completely manufactured by another party. And that other party may also have a CE marking of their own. I mean, the MDR is agnostic about that, but the difference is that you need a full technical documentation, a full quality system, and you need to be able to, to basically completely understand this yourself. So that's the alternative. And then if you are in a situation where somebody else is going to manufacture your whole product, the MDR says that needs to go in the technical documentation. It's actually traceable. Who does that? And also notified bodies will ask for a particular type of agreement in place. And we've seen that before the MDR, or when the UK was still part of the EU, the MHRA had guidance for that. The virtual
manufacturer?
Exactly, which was quite detailed, and I thought it was pretty good guidance. So that is still something that you can look at. And I also know that some notified bodies, for example, DECRA in Netherlands, have also sent very specific letters to their customers saying this is what your agreement should look like. So that's the alternative. And also another alternative would be to say, well, I'm going to use an OEM construction where I will have the product manufactured by somebody who does not have their own CE marking, but who will be a critical supplier to me. It's another way to do it.
I think, yeah, there is a lot of ways. One thing that I want to clarify also, and maybe you can confirm that, is that people are asking me, how can I see if I am a legal manufacturer or if I am a distributor or whoever else? So there is the symbol of the black plant on the product. As soon as you have your name behind it, it means that you are considered as a legal manufacturer. As soon as it is the name of your supplier, it means that you are not the legal manufacturer. Can you confirm that? So that for people to have a...
Oh, that's exactly how it goes. That's also what Article 16.1a provides now. That's the branded distribution. That's another alternative, by the way, good that you mentioned it.
Yeah.
Because if you are going to go for a scenario where somebody else is the manufacturer, but you still put your name on it, fine, then your brand is on the box. The legal manufacturer's name is on the label next to the little black factory, and you need to have an agreement in place that it's not very detailed according to the MDR, just needs to make sure that it's clear who takes the manufacturer role and who takes the distributor role. Yeah,
exactly. I think it's really important because, yeah, there is a lot of misunderstanding. I saw some manufacturers that say, I am an OBL, but it's manufactured by another manufacturer, but I put my name behind the black factory symbol. And then we say, okay, if you are continuing like that, you have to have, as you mentioned, technical file, quality management system, everything, notified body also, CE certificate, etc. So it's something that maybe just to clarify about it.
Symbols are not even clear for manufacturers, that they don't understand that if they put their name behind the manufacturer symbol, that means that they're a manufacturer.
Yeah, I think there is here a lot of misunderstanding because I had some people say, oh, I'm not manufacturer, I'm just receiving the product, but it is this person who manufactures, but it's my name. I am responsible for that. I say, then your labeling or your packaging is wrong. You have to mention your name behind this symbol, because on the UMDR, there is this definition of what is a manufacturer. It's mainly the one that is commercializing the product. It's not just the one that is manufacturing the product.
That's your problem. You need a new regulatory affairs manager, I would say.
Exactly.
Or hire your consultant.
And okay, so last point is, I think I have covered all the questions I wanted to ask you. So the last element is about, we talked about that, I think, during the last podcast with you. It's about your book. You have a book that is released I mean, normally as the date of this episode will go live, the book will be released. So can you tell us more about it? So is it available electronically? Is it available in a bookstore or whatever?
I'm going to sell it as an ebook. So okay. Basically, you can buy it either as a watermarked standard type of document, or you can download it as an EPUB for on your e-reader. Actually, I can show you the cover if you like. Would you like that?
Yeah, show me if I can.
Oh shit. I can't. You have to enable screen sharing for me.
Let me check. Okay. You can go, I think.
Yeah, there we go. Here, this is it.
Okay, enriched MDR and IVDR. So, it's mainly a series of information about. How to interpret the UMDR or IVDR, or it's maybe like
what I've done. Oh, the book will be available. I will put a link on my blog, and then it's a link to the fulfillment services provider that will take your payment and then send you the book. But the book is basically consists of five parts. One is an introductory chapter on the IVDR and the MDR. So it's basically an overview of why they are the way they are, where they come from, how they work, what the big differences between the directives are, new things, thinking behind it. So basically to give you some context. Then the second part is an annotated version of the MDR. So what I've done is I've annotated as many clauses of the MDR as I possibly could in the time that I had. So basically it's the second part is the whole MDR legal text with comments of mine in between.
Okay.
Doing flow charts and all kinds of diagrams, and also a lot of comments, references to publications, references to blogs, references to whatever European case law. Then part three, that is the same, but then for the IVDR. And part four is a bunch of tables that you can use to cross-refer between several parts of these regulations and, for example, the clinical trials regulation. So these are very, very convenient. Basically, they save you a lot of work. There's also a nice table on overlap between the MDR and the IVDR, which will be especially interesting for the IVDR people. So you can basically see where the overlap is, which means that all the places where overlap is stuff that other people have been thinking about for a lot of time already.
Okay.
And then there's a last part with references to other sources of information and abbreviations and that kind of stuff. And I think in total it's going to be about 1,500 pages on your e-reader.
Great. So I think it will be our Bible for us regulators and the ones that are really trying to do that, because each time we are trying to interpret things, and it's great to have a lawyer like you that has experience on that to tell us exactly what is your interpretation of that also. So I will have the link on the show notes. So please go on the show notes to get the book. I will be one of the first to buy it anyway, because as I've said, I will be using that for my daily activities. But don't hesitate to go and to get that. And I hope that we can get you again on the podcast and maybe discuss about some part of it. Again, as soon as I get that, I will pick some elements and we'll maybe make a podcast episode with you about that. Okay. So great. So thank you, really, Eric. As I said, in 1 week we have the MDR. So please, I hope you are ready. If you are not, tell me what is maybe your question or things, and we can try to answer to that. And at the end, the objective is that you are compliant to be placing your device on the market. So brace yourself, MDR is coming. This is mainly the title of this episode. So thank you, Eric. Really, it was a pleasure to have you and talk to you in the next episode. Have a good day.
Likewise. Take care.
Bye.